Then our topic is the management of the acute pancreatitis regarding the clinical aspects, especially the patients who are admitted in intensive care unit or in the intermediate care units. A quick talk about the introduction. The incidence of the acute pancreatitis varies worldwide from 14.7 to 54.1%, as everyone knows. 58% of the cases are mild edematous pancreatitis, 15% of which are severe, represent severe necrotizing pancreatitis, with mortality up to 50%, and general mortality 5% of the cases. Regarding the etiology of the acute pancreatitis, we have together the biliary etiology together with the alcohol-induced etiology representing about 57% of the etiology of the acute pancreatitis. And then comes other etiological factors, which is not as much important, including drug-induced, the post-traumatic, post-ERCP, congenital anomalies, triglycerides, and whatsoever. To summarize my presentation and topic, we are going to discuss the issue by answering the most important 9 questions at the end of the presentation. Hopefully, when we answer the 9 questions, can we manage a case of acute pancreatitis properly? The first question is, does the patient actually have acute pancreatitis or not? Does the patient have biliary pancreatitis if it is diagnosed with pancreatitis? And when he has a biliary pancreatitis, how to manage? Does the patient have mild or severe pancreatitis? And shall the patient be admitted to the intensive care unit? Does the patient need CT diagnostic? Does the patient need an antibiotic? Does the patient need an analgesic? And when yes, which analgesic? Can the patient eat? How much fluid therapy does the patient need and which? And does the patient need the surgeon? This is the last question, means when to apply intervention for the patient. The first question is for the diagnosis, does the patient actually have acute pancreatitis or not? To answer this question, we have to check the revised Atlantic classification. If the patient has 2 or more of the following from the diagnostic criteria, the typical characteristic abdominal pain, together with the biochemical evidence of the pancreatitis in the form of elevation of amylase or lipase more than 3-fold the normal and or radiological evidence of pancreatitis on cross-sectional imaging, whether CT or MRI. However, 2 comments on the points of diagnosis. Sometimes the initial admission of the patient, we can't find elevation of the amylase and lipase, and this doesn't exclude the presence of the acute pancreatitis. That's why if I have the clinical evidence, I should do a CT to confirm my diagnosis. The second point, there is no importance to do a follow-up for the amylase or lipase to see if it's rising or declining. It has nothing to do with the prognosis and the outcome of the patient. That's why once amylase, we don't have to follow up. And CT, we do it only in cases when we don't have a laboratory and clinical evidence of acute pancreatitis. It's not a must to be done at the initial presentation of the patient. Is it biliary pancreatitis or not? To answer the question, we have to take proper history taking from the patient, lab diagnostic cholestatic parameters, and if we find ALT elevation more than 150 international units per liter, this is diagnostic with more than 95% positive predictive value, and in this case, I should do for the patient an ultrasound. In case I didn't find any stones or something in the ultrasound, this doesn't exclude the biliary etiology. I have to do more sophisticated or more advanced techniques like endoscopic ultrasound or to proceed to MRCP if I have the technology where I am. But ALT is a very diagnostic marker when it's over 150 international units per liter. Then I have biliary pancreatitis. When do I have to do an ERCP? 2 indications in case of cholangitis and biliary obstruction, and it should be done within 24 to 72 hours of the initial admission of the patient. The very important question, mild, moderate, severe. According, in order to answer this question, we have to revise the revised Atlanta classification criteria. Mild patient coming with abdominal pain without organ failure, without systemic inflammatory response syndrome or systemic complications. Then skip to the moderate stage, presence of multiple organ failure or systemic complications, which is transient, lasting less than 48 hours. And when it is severe, I should say that it persists more than 48 hours. Why it is important? Why I have to answer the question if it is severe or not? This is because 10 to 20% of the patients having poor outcome with high mortality, this is very important. Early prognosis and diagnosis is very important for the triaging because answering this question will guide me to say, where can I admit my patient? The first initial 24 to 20 to 48 hours are the most critical period in the management of acute pancreatitis because I should know if I have to admit my patient in intensive care unit or intermediate care. overestimation of the condition and admitting every patient in the ICU is just exhaustion of my resources and has many burdens for the cost effectiveness of the treatment. And underestimation is a risk for the patient in order for the proper management. And because I don't have a single predictive factor to say whether the patient has severe or mild acute pancreatitis, there are many, many scoring systems available in order to evaluate if the patient has severe, mild, or moderate pancreatitis. A predictive factor should be early marker, quick and easy, available everywhere, not expensive, with high specificity and sensitivity. And this is unfortunately not available for the acute pancreatitis. And if we just go through the available predictive factors which we have, definitely the clinical evaluation as the most important predicting with a typical abdominal pain. Initial simple predictive factors like if I have hematocrit value, for example, which is high, if I have urea more than 25 milligram per deciliter within the first 24 hours of the admission, if I have elevated CRP level more than 150 milligram per deciliter, hypocalcemia or manifestations of systemic inflammatory response syndrome, this can guide to the presence of the severe pancreatitis. These are the simple without scoring systems which done routinely in every emergency care unit when the patient is admitted. If I check the scores, we have clinical and laboratory scores like the harmless acute pancreatitis score. This is a German score, and it is very simple and constitutes of three predictors or markers, which are the absence of rebound tenderness or rigidity, creatinine less than 2, and hematocrit value, which is normal. If I have these three components, then I'm talking about harmless acute pancreatitis or mild. Then I have the other scores, the Ranson score, the bedside index of severity of acute pancreatitis score, the Apache score, and radiological scores to assess the pancreatic fluid collections. Going through the scores very quickly, Ranson is one of the oldest scores, and I think it's the most famous and widely used and spread from all the available scores. It checks the patient's condition on the admission and after 48 hours, and the point gets points. The patient, accordingly, you can triaging the patient. Patient who has more than 3 points should be admitted in the intensive care. With high sensitivity and specificity is the Ranson score, but the most the important disadvantage of the score that you evaluate the patient on admission and after 48 hours from the admission. This is a problem. Another score is the bedside index of severity in acute pancreatitis. As we mentioned, this is a little simpler score in comparison to the Ranson. And the patient clicks points according to the urea, mental status, inflammatory response syndrome, age, pleural effusion. More than 3 points means that the patient should be admitted to the intensive care unit, but the problem is that it cannot assess the organ failure if it's something transient or it is something permanent to say if it's moderate or severe, but it helps somehow. And the Apache score, this is the acute physiology and chronic health evaluation score. This is one of the most commonly used scores, but it's more almost used in the intensive care unit, not only for the acute pancreatitis, but for other critical illnesses. It's a little bit complicated and involves many parameters, either clinical or lab parameters. That's why it's a little bit difficult to apply. And patients with more than 8 points should be admitted in the intensive care unit. After we discussed some of the available scoring systems, the answer is that there is no scoring system which is superior to the other. And at the end, maybe we should combine different scoring systems together and we can say this is the best one and it predicts the best outcome of the patient. Most of the scoring systems available have a negative predictive value, which is high, low positive predictive value, and that's why it can exclude patients with low mortality risk, but cannot say about the patients with R at a higher mortality risk. No ideal predictor, no gold standard. And that's why the key assessment in the patients with acute pancreatitis is daily evaluation of the patients, clinical evaluation, lab values, because as we see in this diagram, that the acute pancreatitis, the severe form, has two peaks, the early initial phase, which is in the first 10 days. This means that after improvement of the patients, after the initial first 10 days, we can have a second peak, which is the late phase, with the worsening of the condition of the patient due to the development of the local complications, like the fluid collections, which we will discuss in the coming slides. Does the patient need a CT? As we mentioned previously at the beginning of the presentation, we don't have to do a CT when the patient comes with a definite diagnosis of amylase, lipase, and abdominal pain. We need always the CT in the second stage when we have local complications like abscess, necrosis, and we have to evaluate the condition to start management accordingly. Important question, does the patient need an antibiotic? It's not routine. We shouldn't apply antibiotic prophylactically from the beginning without evidence of infection, either laboratory evidence or clinical evidence from the beginning. Because in this case, what's against adding prophylactic antibiotic? It leads to development of multi-resistant bacteria, increased the rate of fungal infections, and increased the incidence of mortality. That's why we should only apply antibiotic treatment only in cases of therapeutic conditions when we have an evidence of acute pancreatitis. And this evidence is indicated by elevated infectious parameters, clinical manifestations of sepsis, or radiological evidence of pancreatic necrosis or pseudocysts, and the pathogens, as we all know, like gram-negative bacteria, gram-positive, or anaerobes and fungal infections. What to apply or what to give? We have the carbapenem and the imipenem, which is recommended from the guidelines and is widely used. But alternatives, we can also give like clindamycin, piperacillin, fluoroquinolone, metronidazole, and the most important is EMA, is always culture and sensitivity. And that's why when I have a patient with the evidence of infection or signs of infection, I have to do simultaneously blood culture. And if I can gain a sample from the pancreatic fluid collection or necrosis in order to give accordingly, because the fungal infection is very common in these situations. And sometimes we have fever and we have worsening of the patient's condition, although the patient is under antibiotics because we simply didn't apply antifungal from the beginning. Then the next question is, does the patient need analgesic or painkiller or not? This is a study conducted in our hospital and from our pancreas study group. And it measures the relationship between the duration of pain during the before the hospital admission and the severity of the pancreatitis. And in this graph, we can see that the longer the duration of the pain before the hospital admission, the more severe the situation of the acute pancreatitis with a median of 27 hours. And the longer the duration of pain before the hospital admission means the more severity of the acute pancreatitis, and the older patients have, what we found in our study, that the older patients have lower pain threshold. The answer is, do I have to give the patient analgesic? Definitely yes, I have to give something for the pain. There is no recommended consensus which analgesic is better in comparison to the other in which doses. There was previously recommendations to avoid opioids because it led to more ileus in a patient who already has ileus and had a general bad condition, and because it leads to the increase in the tone of the papilla of water in the ampulla. And that's why it was recommended previously to try to avoid morphine as much as possible because it would worsen the condition, and try to use other analgesics, but it is not anymore in the recommendations. The recommendations, the new, just say give morphine if the patient needs, or give opioids when the patient needs this, and this wouldn't worsen the condition. And the analgesics are given according to the pain therapy guidelines of the WHO, and it is tailored according to the patient's situation. Is enteral nutrition allowed? The question is yes or no. Should the patient eat or not? Previously, it was just said that the theory and the concept of pancreatic risk, and that the patient shouldn't take anything per oral, and we stop introducing any enteral nutrition. It's not anymore recommended. Now the guidelines are recommending we should introduce the enteral nutrition as early as possible. Within the first 48 hours, we should introduce. And this has a better outcome concerning all aspects: maintenance of the intestinal motility, intestinal barrier, proper management of the infection. It reduces the secondary infection and reduces the incidence of systemic organ failure and infectious complications with multi-organ failure and mortality. And that's why when the patient eats or can tolerate, I should introduce the food. And if the patient has nausea or vomiting or can tolerate like swallowing, we can apply the enteral nutrition through a nasogastric or nasojejunal tube. And concentrating on the nutrition, because patients are in a high catabolic state and really need good nutrition and good nutritive supportive care.
Professor Mayeda, we're running out of time, please. May you highlight the remaining lines of treatment?
The last line, which is the most important line of treatment now, is the fluid therapy. The patient should this is the cornerstone of management, because as we saw that most of the factors are like supportive measures, and that's why the fluid is the most important. What are the causes of fluid loss? Very quickly, nausea, vomiting, paralytic ileus, ascites, effusion, inflammatory edema, oxidation, and so on. I need to compensate the patients with fluid as early as possible, because if we look quickly to this diagram, necrosis and vital tissue, I need this gray area, which is still supplied with a little bit of collaterals from the vascular circulation. I need to convert this area into vital instead of a necrotic area. That's why I have to maintain a microvascular circulation and improve the peripheral tissue oxygenation of the patient. And this is maintained with a proper fluid replacement therapy. There is no choice or consensus which to give Ringer or crystalloid or colloid. Ringer lactate has anti-inflammatory effect. How much fluid shall I take? There is no consensus. There is a say 5 to 10 milliliters per kilogram or 2.5 for 4 liters a day. However, that's why it's very important to give the patient a goal. Directed therapy regarding every patient I have to tailor the fluid replacement therapy regarding every situation of every patient according to his needs, with non-invasive markers or with invasive markers, non-invasive like the general heart rate, mean arterial pressure, urine output, or whatever. But what's important for me is the extensive hemodynamic monitoring, which is invasive. I would like, before I end my talk, about this EAGLE study. It's a very important study because it is a multicentric study. It was conducted in our center, including 20 centers, involving 182 patients, randomizing the patient in two groups, the standard group, which measurement of the central venous pressure, mean arterial pressure, heart rate, lab values, in comparison to the other group, which is the PICO group, and to whom who don't know what's the PICO, this is a kind of arterial invasive assessment of the hemodynamic circulation through using an arterial assessment. And by this way, I can know the end-diastolic volume and the preload of the patient. This stands for the pulse control cardiac output, global end-diastolic volume, extravascular lung water index, pulmonary edema, and stroke variabilities, so that I have a 24-hour monitoring of the patient, and I can give the fluid replacement therapy directed according to the patient needs and not just as what recommended in the general guidelines. My last question is, does the patient need a surgeon? This only in cases of pancreatic fluid collections, pancreatic necrosis, drainage, or necrosectomy. We wouldn't discuss this issue today because the time wouldn't allow us. So I would go quickly without mentioning. This was just like explaining the pancreatic fluid collections and how to manage them. But this is the only indication in order to manage the pancreatic fluid collections as we see them, either surgical or endoscopic or percutaneous drainage. And this needs to be discussed in a session. What do we do with a pancreatic fluid collection? And the time doesn't allow us right now. That's why I would end my presentation by highlighting the important points which we discussed at the beginning of the presentation. Does the patient have acute pancreatitis? Clinical picture and lipase, this is the answer. Does the patient have biliary pancreatitis? History, cholestatic parameters, ultrasound, endosonography. Does the patient need an ERCP? Yes, in case of cholangitis and biliary obstruction. Does the patient have severe acute pancreatitis? Shall be admitted to the ICU? This could be answered according to the scoring system, which we discussed. Does the patient need a CT if we are suspecting the occurrence of the complications? Antibiotic prophylactic, yes. Therapeutic, no. Does the patient need painkiller? Yes, and most probably opioids. Is the patient allowed to eat, please, as early as possible? Enter nutrition introduction. How much fluid, invasive hemodynamic monitoring, and goal-directed fluid therapy according to the patient situation. Does the patient need surgery? We didn't discuss this point, but quickly, the endoscopic treatment of the pancreatic collections is much more recommended rather than the surgical, which has a high mortality rate in comparison to the endoscopic, and every case should be discussed single case situation and not as general. Thank you very much. And I hope—
Thank you, Professor Mayeda. And due to shortage of time, we have to shift to our next speaker, Professor Dina Omar, one of our eminent pathologists, and she's Professor of Histopathology in Cairo University. May you please start your elegant presentation?
Good afternoon. I will start now.
Thank you.
I have a problem too. Thank you, May.
And, thank you, Dr. Dina.
May, and I want to thank Dr. Sirag, of course, for inviting me and all the Egyptian society. I don't know why I have a problem in sharing.
Please, we have a technical support.
It's can you see my screen now?
Not yet. Zoom. I'm calling for technical support. Professor Mohamed Magdi, will you please ask for technical support?
For example, a problem is from your side, Cordina. You don't know how to share your screen? Up till now? Open the presentation first, the background, then share your screen.
I already opened my presentation.
And you have the green button down, the share screen button. You should press it.
I had it locked.
The green button down the screen.
I clicked share, but it doesn't share.
And you open the presentation in the background? It's opened or not?
The presentation is open here with me.
Okay, can you double click on the presentation, please? Can you double click on it?
Okay. In Zoom, لازم recording دي allow it. Okay.
What happened to the screen when you press the share screen to the Dr. Dina? What message?
I want best and I'm to share. No.
I'm trying to
select presentation from the.
I don't have the main screen anymore.
Of the presentation or the Zoom?
Of the Zoom meeting.
If I minimize the phone.
أفتح تاني بش أدخل تاني على الميتينج.
هل بتلاقيها فوق على الجنب في البداية؟ إذا minimize بتظهر ال PowerPoint هي اللي بتبقى واضحة عند حضرتك.
I have the PowerPoint on my desktop now. It's open, but it doesn't share. Just a second. I will leave and get and rejoin the meeting.
Can you send it to us on the email to share it from here?
Okay. I can send it, yes, to you. Can I send it to you now immediately? I will join the meeting.
Or might we have another presentation to start with till we solve the problem, or this is the last one in the session? Dr. Dina, what's going on right now? Yes. You look at now. Okay, please start.
Yes, it's okay. It's shared. You can start.
Please unmute your mic, Dr. Dina.
Enable the microphone.
Unmute your mic, please.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, I'll be very quick about the pathology of acute pancreatitis. Of course, as a pathologist, we never see a biopsy for diagnosis of acute pancreatitis. We only see fine needle aspirate, maybe, in few times. I will not go through the etiology. Dr. Mayada said everything about the etiology. I only care about the pathology. All the etiological factor would end up with the same pathogenesis, which is the autodigestion. The normal exocrine pancreas is formed of SNI and ducts. And what protects the pancreas from being eaten by its own enzymes are that the enzymes are secreted in an inactive way and inside the ducts. Anything that causes the activation of the enzymes in the wrong place or time will cause the autodigestion. So all the etiologies will end up with the same autodigestion, namely the proteases will be activated. They will eat the wall of the blood vessels causing hemorrhage. The amylases will be secreted into the blood. This is what the clinicians see as increase in the amylase in the serum. The lipase will cause the fat necrosis, which consume the calcium, one of the causes of the hypocalcemia. And of course, there is all these will cause destruction of the SNI of the exocrine pancreas. The pathogenesis is not that simple, only autodigestion. Animal models prove that there is involvement of complement, of the clotting system, of cytokines, of free radicals, genetic mutation, and the nuclear factor kappa B activation. Grossly, of course, we see edema. It's an acute inflammation, edema of the pancreas with yellow areas of parenchymal necrosis inside and yellow areas of fat necrosis outside with white calcium and, of course, the dark hemorrhagic areas. In the microscopic picture, and this I should never see because there is no role for tissue biopsy, I'm allowed only to see this in a book or postmortem. But what should we see is acute inflammation with the hemorrhage, again, the parenchymal necrosis and the fat necrosis. 80% of cases we call it interstitial acute pancreatitis with little hemorrhage and necrosis, and only 20% of cases are the severe hemorrhagic necrotizing pancreatitis, and these correspond to the severe cases clinically. What's important here is not the microscopic picture, it's the fine needle aspirate, the EOS guided fine needle aspirate cytology. And this is what I can see in cases of acute pancreatitis. For a pathologist, we see an inflammatory smear full of acute inflammatory cells, neutrophils, we call it polymorphs, a lot of red blood cells, and we see the epithelial cells of the parenchyma of the exocrine pancreas in various stages of degeneration and regeneration. And these cells are ugly cells. This means they look like dysplastic and malignant cells, and this is the problem. You can get a false positive for malignancy report. That's why you need an experienced cytopathologist to see the fine needle, and you can get a false negative malignancy report, and this can be excluded by the on-site cytology. If the cytopathologist see the cells that not as ugly as usual, that really looks like a malignant cell, on the spot, the cytopathologist will ask for more fine needle aspirate distal or around the area. The differential diagnosis of this inflammatory smear as a diagnosis, it can be acute pancreatitis, but also it can be a smear from an abscess, a pseudocyst, or even in the vicinity of a carcinoma. The complication of acute pancreatitis, of course, in 20% of cases, we said it's the severe form, the necrotizing hemorrhagic pancreatitis. And here they accused the nuclear factor kappa B. Also, the systemic response with the cytokine storm and the interleukin 6 is mostly involved here. Infections, of course, due to the gut bacterial translocation, and the overall death is about 5%. Also, the complications include the pancreatic pseudocyst and the chronic pancreatitis. So what I want to say here, Just to be very quick, there is no role for tissue biopsy for the diagnosis of acute pancreatitis. To diagnose acute pancreatitis, you can send me an EOS guided fine needle aspirate and be aware of the false positive malignancy report and the false negative malignancy report. And we can exclude these but by having the on-site cytology unit. So think about the on-site cytology. It's rapid, it's easy, and it's exactly like the frozen section in the OR. And that's it, and thank you.
Professor Dina, it was a marvelous presentation, very rapid, concise, and very, very informative. Thank you very much, Yanni. You did something miraculous. Thank you very much. We would like to thank our speakers, Professor Mayeda and Professor Dina, for this very rich and concise. And actually, the topic was very hot, and it needed a whole session and a whole day to discuss it. But he could inform us and tell all the information that we wanted to reach our audience. And thank you very much for our audience. Thank you very much, Professor Dr. Mohamed Magdi. We need another, it's just, it was some sort of an attraction for our audience for our next webinar that we need to do it for a whole day to discuss every issue and every said is really worthy that you have to discuss it in a separate session. Thank you very much, very, very for Professor Mayeda and Professor Dean.
Thank you, Professor May, for the